it's very important to say that although I am an engineering manager, I am still an engineer. So yes, it's one of us, you know, it's very important to make that clear. And why I'm going to talk to you about Agile. Well, as I said, I am the manager for the SRE team. I don't know about you, but I do hope that you know that the SRE is one of the most problematic areas in all companies. If you have a fire, the SRE team is the one who is going to be there to put it out. And one of the problems that we have as SREs is we have to try a lot of agile techniques. We have to deal with a lot of teams that works into different aspects of agile, that navigates through different scenarios. And I have been doing this for the past 10 years, a little bit more. And my work as an SRE manager and SRE myself is to try to make a smoother sea for better marineers. So today's forecast for our travel, we're going to talk about the compass, the guide that brought us here. We're going to talk a little bit about the myths of the sea that we face and how to streamline the ship to navigate to those seas. Hope you are already using your life vests. Let's go for it. So, the compass. I think you all know this one, don't you? Have you all seen this sometime in the past or maybe a few days ago? This was the manifesto for agile software development, and it was crafted in 2001, but the first draft of it was done in 1995. Do you know which languages we had to develop in 1995? I don't, but I think Delphi and Java were some of them. Well, the things that this compass told us is that we should be focused on individuals and interactions, on building working software, providing customer collaboration, and more than that, responding to change over following a plan. Okay, strange, isn't it? But when we use the compass and get into the real sea, this is what we face. We see companies going and speaking about agile, going full agile for everyone, or implementing something that will help us do half of the work, double the time. No, it was the other way, right? Yes, it was double the work in half of the time. Or the Scrum methodology. Again, I'm not an agile coach. I'm not here to talk bad about agile. I'm just here to talk and explain a little bit about my experience. So with Scrum, what you're get? You're gonna get sprints, you're gonna get ceremonies, you're gonna get a lot of tasks to be done on a planned way according to your team capacity. We're gonna get there. And if you're not into Scrum, you're probably into Kanban. Or maybe you're using Scrumba and doing all of them together. So you're going to have a magic tool. You're going to have a lot of boards. You're going to have a lot of tickets going fast and forward or not. And if you have a true DevOps mindset, everything that you have will break into every release that you do weekly or not. We'll see a little bit more about that. So for every senior leader that we face, I guess, I don't know if we have any senior leader in here, you know, directors or above. Thank you so much. that's the way that I can speak freely. For senior leadership, if you choose one of those monsters, Scrum or Kanban, and you install Jira, you're agile. That's it. It's time to go and navigate through the sea. And the first problem happens when you choose Scrum or Scrumba. or a mix of those. That is not really a problem. It's a myth that you're going to have ceremonies and everybody will join and collaborate with each other. It will be amazing. You're going to have 1 hour of refinement sessions to prepare the team to discuss the projects that are coming. You're also going to have 1 hour of planning sessions to prepare your team for the tasks that you have already refined and needs to be worked. And if you sum up and you have a very small team with very brief talks, you're going to have 15 minutes of daily meetings every day to discuss what you have been doing, how are the blocks that you are facing, and where you're moving. So if everything goes right or not, you're going to face a retrospective by the end of that cycle. Usually, the vast majority of us works into 2 week cycles. This means that we're going to have a 1 hour and a half of retrospectives, 45 minutes each week distributed by that work. Looks easy, don't you? But what truly happens is that this is the common agenda for almost every developer, engineer manager, or anyone that I've been talking to for the past 5 years, I guess. Because, you know, you went to the refinement, it was not all right. You have to go to another session to re-refine the stuff that you were discussing. And then you have another team that needs that refinement session to be done. And then you meet with them, and then you come back and discuss with your team. And then, you know, you enter for the statistic someday, hopefully not, because you're now going to learn how to solve this. If not, you're going to enter to the statistic that the vast majority of heart attacks happens between the end of Sunday and the beginning of Monday. Well, if my agenda looked like this, I was probably having a heart attack. Have you all seen anything different from this? Is this something that you see on your everyday life? Okay, let's pass through another myth. The next one. I love this one. This one is, with Agile, you see and know where your team is going to deliver everything. Agile, for the senior leadership, is the way that they do and know where some project is going to be delivered, and not how the teams were going to work with each other. But if everything goes right, is going to have estimation saying how many hours it will take to develop that amazing feature. Or if the team is that, you know, not that young, you're going to have the estimation in effort, which is more complex and even more disturbing. And if you're not into hours or not into effort, you may have working days. So you know that, for example, to implement a button in the front end, you take half a day. But if you have to implement a button in the API contract behind it, you have 1 working day to implement it, and everything will be all right. And with that, of course, your engineering manager, me, can go to the director and say, hey, for the past 3 months, the team was able to deliver 32 points. And with that, I can say to you that we're going to take 2 other sprints to deliver the 64 points project that we're going to face. Nothing changed. Everything is all right, isn't it? Yeah. But life is what happens while you're making plans. But can you ask me a question? Or answer me a question, please? If my team has a 32 points velocity, but John has a 3-hour appointment with a dentist, and Mary goes sick for 2 days, what is the final velocity? How many points am I going to deliver? Pois é. Oh, yeah, baby. And, you know, no one has unpredictability in our lives, right? You don't wake up in the morning, kick the bed and go, ah, now you're gonna go to the doctor with a broken feet, 4 hours without working, expecting the ambulance and everything. You know, that's it. So you can say to me, we are planning for the unplanned. We can foresee and prepare a buffer zone. Ah, I love buffer zones. You know, because if you have a predicted velocity, you can know when the delivery is going to be. And you can know what could fail. So you plan accordingly, deliver the buffer zone, and leave some tasks in there that you will aim to not deliver. Smart, isn't it? Okay. So there's a guy who was very smart and came a lot before me who get this law defined, which is work, expense, to fill the allotted time for its completion, which means that, okay, you now know that your team has a 32 points velocity and you can deliver 32 points by sprint. What you do, you aim to really point tasks and put that into the sprint that will sum up for 28 points. Now you have a slack, you have a buffer zone to burn. But your team sees that, and go. So I have a button that really would take me 1 point to be delivered. But now I have 3, so what can I do? I can take 3 points, why not? And this is not, you know, I'm not saying that your engineers or my engineers or even me, you know, we are procrastination machines. But that happens. If you're not on a deadline, why should you care about it? So, and what happens is that you may have this burned out chart. Has someone of you do one of those burned out charts? Okay. And if you are, okay, if you have calculated everything right and your buffer zone is completely fine, you're gonna have this one, which means that everything was carried out. And then in the last day, some hero came and boom, all merge requests are merged. Everything is delivered. This team rocks and is amazing. Well, is it a myth that you have been seeing? Do you have any different experience? Okay. So, and then you came to me and say, don't worry, man. I don't care about Scrum. My life and my work is in Kanban. In Kanban, we do not have those ceremonies. Therefore, no crazy agenda. In Kanban, we do not need that much of discussion and planning. We take tasks and complete them, and that's it. And we do that by controlling the whip. So in Kanban, you have the myth of limited workflow. You have atomic and clear tasks that everybody on the teams knows what needs to be done. And the fast forward procedure is the law. Everything that enters on the board is taken into completion. And you know, if you have every information distributed and if your team is amazing and rocks every day, no meetings are needed, right? Okay, but then reality knocks. Does this look like one of your boards? Have you all seen this? Or maybe, you know, the Thursday after 2 weeks, the 2 weeks period that is not a sprint for you, but you get into Thursday right next to the delivery of a project, and this looks like the quality assurance guy queue. This is the amount of work he has to test, and this is not going to be done. But okay, what really happens if you're not into that point? Your team will be hoarding tickets. You're going to have centers of knowledge inside your team. So for example, only John works with network requests. Only Anna works with CSS or JavaScript requests. and only Fabio will save your ass if something goes wrong. You know? And if this is the way that your team works, what you're going to have is the worst burn approach, which is lots of meetings will appear. You're going to come back to the agenda that I showed previously because nothing is clear. You have to come to Fabio to solve everything. You have to come to John to resolve any network issue. John and Fabio will be in a lot of meetings. And Anna, since you do not have that much work of CSS to be implemented, Anna will be numanize. So what happens after that is your team will be blind. No one knows what each other people or person in the team is doing. You're going to have people who knows and solve almost everything, people who's in the company and in the team for 2 to 5 years and doesn't know how to solve anything else. And of course, you're going to have those guys that doesn't take vacations, not because they don't believe in it or they don't need it, but just because they are not comfortable on leaving a sack of stuff to the team to solve. Has anyone experienced anything different than this? Okay. You know, I'm getting with a lot of fear, but let's move on. So, after some period, you have tried Scrum, you have tried Kanban, and with all of them, you understood that what your team really needs is an hour and a half communication session called the retrospective, or as SREs, in our case, we have postmortems. We have postmortems about issues and incidents and postmortems about initiatives. Well, in a retrospective, what you're going to have is all the working procedures of your team will be reviewed. Your team, by doing that, will guarantee that everyone speaks their heart and that your team is moving into a continuous improvement pace, right? Because you are always reviewing, interacting, and collecting feedback. And you guarantee that in that space, you have safety to speak their minds. Everybody can come with the stuff that wasn't that good during that period and can say to each other. Isn't that right? Okay. What really happens is that you're going to have, or maybe you have, a lot of repeating teams. The team is constantly unhappy about the amount of tasks that they have to do, or a lot of tasks are unclear and have to be discovered during the sprint or during the work. The sessions that you have with the team are very harsh with the people. You have people getting emotional, you have people getting demotivated, and nobody feels safe to say what they need to say. Everybody answers that they are happy, that everything is good, that you need to refine better the tasks, and that's it. What's going to happen is after 3 to 5 months, you're going to see someone leaving, and then another people leaves, and then you look through the window and there's no team anymore. There's only one manager, or maybe not even the manager, and the plugin or the intern waiting to hold the candles and to see if the boat is going to get somewhere. Is this different from anything that you have been seeing? Okay. And this is the agile that we all have been seeing for a while now. How can we streamline the ship and get it to a place where we would perform better, and this happens, and this actually exists, we could be happier with our work. So, for the agenda overflow, and there's an icon in there that I would like you to take note and to see it, because it's going to link everything in the end. So, for the agenda overflow, make meetings optional. Oh, this is hard, isn't it? So you can still have the 1 hour refinement. You can still have the 25 minutes stakeholder status to inform everybody about the ongoing projects. You can still have the planning sessions. And of course, you should still have the retrospective sessions. But if you do this in the right way with the right people, if you make a commitment with your team and guarantee that you write stuff down, that you documented, your agenda could look like this. This is actually my agenda for an okay week. So you can see here, of course, I removed the name of the projects and the status of them, but you can see that I have some focus times here and there. I have a stakeholder meeting that I hold with the person which is responsible for some project in my team. And that person responsible for that project is only the person who knows and guarantee that everything around that project is documented. Okay. One explanation here. I am an engineer. I am an engineering manager. But it's not up to me to define projects in my team. I'm not coding anymore, or I should not be coding, you know? My function is not to discuss and to tell my team how they should do their work. They are the people who should do this. That's why I have an initiative driver for every initiative that my team is doing. My team right now has 12 people, and we have four projects, four big initiatives going alongside each other, which means that we have four initiative drivers into different levels. One of those guys was an intern 6 months ago, and he's driving an initiative right now. And this is what happens. I go with him into some meetings. He's the one responsible for defining the tasks, defining the projects, and aligning everything with the team asynchronously. Write stuff down. And then this is what happens. This is a modern agile solution for the agenda overflow issue. Any questions so far? Okay, moving on. And the refinements. Well, refinement sessions. Refinement sessions, we have a decision called chartering. What is chartering? For every project that we start, we have a clear purpose of that project. So every time that we receive a request, there are three questions that we ask the person or the team who is asking us to deliver some project. There is, who is going to benefit from that project? How this project aligns with the company's current goals? And what is the context that we need for that project? What this project needs to do and where it should not fail to be delivered. With those three information, I can align with my team. I can convince them that they should do that project, or the contrary, I can convince the people on the other side that, sorry, this project doesn't go in the way that you're speaking to, so we're not doing it right now. And I came from a consultant past. I was a consultant for 7 years of my life. And I learned a lesson that is, you never say no to a customer. You raise the price. So you do not say that you are not going to do that project, but it doesn't fit your yearly projects. It's going to have to move to Q5. And, you know, Q5 is like August. So, for every project we do that, and we guarantee that the initiative driver assigned to that initiative knows how to answer those questions. This is documented into your preferred Confluence space. And then we define a refinement session with the team. In our proper refinement session, what we discuss is what needs to be done. So my team united says, how they face or think that that initiative could be delivered. What in that initiative cannot fail by the answers that we had previously, and who or what from this initiative, if it fails, if it's the company, if it's some specific customer, if it is the developers group, ooh, shame on them. And if we have a deadline for the project, we're not accepting the deadline as it is. We can decide, and if this is decided by us, we're gonna define the initiative driver to review the tasks and guarantee where those tasks should be done according to what initiative that we have ongoing and what is the size of that initiative, just because we know estimatives is a finger in the air, nothing more than that. Everything can happen. And if this deadline is given, what we're gonna do is we're gonna do this into a Gantt chart, prepare a proper presentation, and tell the people as soon as we know what needs to be done, what can fit that deadline. And that's it. This is how we negotiate projects and problems. There are some people in here that has seen me doing initiative discussion in that way, and can tell you, I know, Diana, was this exactly done? Okay, so I'm not lying by myself. I have Diana to lie with me. Thank you so much. And if we have everything completed and the team believes in that initiative, we have a clear purpose that aligns with the purpose with the team and the company. And if everything is defined, we then define when and how do we check on this work. Is it something that we only need to go to the board and see? Me, myself, and I, in this case. Is it something that we need recurring meetings? Because some customers could be affected. We have to communicate with other areas. What are those areas? Who are they? How can we talk with them? And this is how we predict when a project will fit. What I try to do a lot is predict quarter by quarter. So in October, November, I am planning for the next year with my team on the initiatives that my team wants to do. So everything that they believe should be done for the next year. After that, I go and talk with the main stakeholders that I have, collecting their initiatives. I put everything into a bucket. We sit down with the team and we discuss the priorities according to the company's priority. And then this moves forward. Every quarter I review this, or every month I review. Every quarter I sit down with my team and we plan for the next quarter doing exactly the same stuff. And okay, and you say, but how can you define this process? Is this a process that works for everybody? Or better, I've heard this a lot. This is not something that suits any team. You have to be prepared. Okay, not entirely. There's no one law about Agile. What works for one team doesn't work for another team, and maybe not even works for the same team after 6 months. So what you should do to review your process according to the way that you want to work. A static meeting. What is the best feature Kanban ever brought us? So you unite yourself with your team. You discuss your project, your approach to work. So what is your customer? Who are you serving to? What is the purpose of this team existing inside this company? You know, my team, my SRE team, is actually a cloud operations and SRE team, which means that we are the main responsibles to maintaining infrastructure and to solving and guiding developers to use that infrastructure. So we know that all developers of the company are our customers, and that every customer of the company is our customer, because if everything goes down, we need to act. What are the sources of dissatisfaction. From where is the team collecting unhappiness now? From where is it coming? Is it from internal sources? Is it external? Do we have anything that is not working right and should be or not? After that, we understand and analyze our demand, our input sources. If we only have projects coming from a PO and we have to give candies to this PO to guarantee that everything will come in the right place and we'll describe it. Or if we have projects from the PO and we also have requests coming from developers that cannot access their machines. And if we have incidents coming from customers that's for some weird reason started getting 401s and blame the company for that. And after analyzing the demand, understanding the input we defined, what we're going to do with the delivery of it. Do we need two boards? Do we need one board? What are the lanes that we need? How do we want to see the work that is being done? Doing that, we see the service delivery flow, which is basically reviewing how we're going to work on that main flow that we design. How are the steps working with each other? If we have to do in progress, if we have blocked, if we have waiting for customer, what is the workflow that we have from waiting for customer if a request can be closed after 7 days without answer or something like that? And then you define the classes of services, define your true board using Kanban or something like that, and design the social experiment or the social negotiate implementation of your team. How are you going to defend that purpose that you have agreed on this meeting? So who needs to go there and talk with the customers of the team to explain to them what is the priority on which your team works? How you're going to guarantee that during the work, this static flow is followed. And after that, how you reanalyze this flow, when you should meet again to review if everything went right or bad and what you should change. So far, clear? Okay. Velocity. Isn't that beautiful? So measuring velocity, after you implemented everything, are you still going to punctuate stuff? Are you still going to see how many hours it will take for you to deliver a feature or something like that? No. If you really do this, and if you really want to move to a blameless culture, data metrics is the way to go. We have been talking about data metrics for 10 years now, I think. And what is that? You do not measure how long it takes for each request go into each one of the lines on your Kanban. You see what is the deployment frequency of your team, how long it takes from a task to be started and for a deployment from that task to occur. You measure the lead time, how long it takes to have everything aligned, to have the planets doesn't collide with themselves, and then have that feature in production for the customers. What is the change failure rate? How many merge requests are failing? What are the sources of those failures? And if something breaks, how long it takes you to get everything back on their feet? So there's no way of moving forward if it doesn't change the metrics that you are collecting. And if you change the metrics but don't change the process behind them, you are going to measure vanity metrics. Okay, and then we move forward. Everything went all right. We defined a process with our team. We are working with data metrics. We know the velocity, the proper velocity of our team. We know that we usually take a week to release a feature in production for our 600 customers around the world. And something failed. A project went down. The customer is unhappy, threatening to process us or to sue us. And we need to hold a retrospective. So how do we start it? The first rule of every retrospective, and I shouldn't be here talking with this about it. This is something that is obvious, but what is obvious doesn't exist, is you have to promote psychological safety in your teams. So retrospectives, you cannot have fear in that. You have to promote trust and respect between team members. You have to apply feedback and feed forward. And for all of you who never seen this, this is a radical candor graph, which is the way to go for feedbacks, retrospectives, and conversations inside your team. Radical Candor is a book from Kim Scott. I highly recommend it. The quote in that book that is used to sell it is how to get what you want by saying what you mean. And this is the way to go for retrospectives in an actionable and understandable way. So if you're going to a retrospective, first guarantee that you have no concurrent meetings on your retrospective with your team, that everybody in there is engaged and aware of what's going on. And as a mediator myself, I go to retrospectives to listen, not to say anything. I do not put cards on the board. I only understand and see what my team is feeling. So if you are managers or if you have managers, ask them politely, please, to step down on retrospectives and let the team talk. The program or the process for the manager is to ask questions and understand what's causing the pain. So use the clear method. You can take a screenshot. You have the presentation later and send this to our manager. Hey, look the lecture that I went to. It's amazing. You're going to love it. And then he's going to see the clear. For every manager, for everyone who's holding retrospectives, be curious, caring, and open-minded. Understand that around you, you have people, you have everybody dealing with their own problems, and you may not know what led to any issue that you had. Be clear to listen to one another, and do not start speaking if that person did not finish. Encourage everyone to contribute and to speak. If you have passed through a hot topic into a retrospective and you see, you know, in a team of four people, you see three talking, it's the time to stop and ask the fourth one for their opinion. And avoid dominating or interrupting when people are talking, even though if you not agree on what they are saying, this is their opinion, not yours. You have to respect it and guarantee that you repeat and review their points. Sometimes it's not what they say, but what they mean that you have to review and that needs to be taken into account. And another one on retrospective is, I mentioned feedback and feed forward. Have you ever listened about feed forward? Feedback, you all know. You made poo-poo, and then someone came and crawl. Feed forward is the other way around. It's what I expect you to do so this poo-poo doesn't repeat. What you should be doing or what you should be paying attention so you do not repeat the same mistakes you have done in the past. And for that, we use the coin method. Context. You have to be clear and say when and where the event occurred. So, for example, in that meeting, you were a little bit aggressive with your colleagues. And my observation around it is that I had fear from the way that you were speaking. I got, you know, scared. So this is not a good place to be. I do not like to be scared at work. I would prefer you. So you observed the way that the person speak, the impact. You were fearful, and then I would expect you from the next time to control your emotions and be clear on what you expect. I do know that you do not need to agree with everybody or that you do not agree with that specific person, but I hope that in the next time you brief in before engaging into a discussion, or that you bring to me the matter and I'll solve it between you two. See, the coin method in action is the context observation you made, the impact that it had on you. So it's not about the other person, it's about how you felt on that incident and what you think should be done on the next time. So all of these sections are part of a framework called Modern Agile. Modern Agile focus on four values, which are make people as awesome, so the yellow heart. Experiment and learn rapidly, which is that, you know, glass over there. Deliver value continuously instead of planning, replanning, and redoing. And the most important one, make safety a prerequisite. If you had an incident in life because your intern accessed the database and deleted some roles, the problem is that you do not have a process to guarantee that your intern cannot delete roles into production. And it's not a matter of revoking their access. It's a matter of telling them that they should not do stuff in production. Or if it does something into production, you have a way to get it back, to roll back the transactions. If you do not have an automatic transactions in your database, maybe you need to hire a DBA. If you have a DBA, do not have automatic transactions, maybe you need to pay a course for this DBA to learn how to DBA. And that's life. So that's almost it. I know. For you, before you're going to work tomorrow and make a revolution, answer some checking questions. It's questions for you to take to work, to take to your boss, or to take home and reflect upon it. Which are, which one of those myths are you fighting today? Do you have a complete agenda? Do you have velocity and predictability always failing because this doesn't exist? Where are you? Which one of those pains are you feeling? And if you have some of them, do you really feel comfortable pointing out and discussing them with your manager or your team? If not, is it something that you feel that your opinion matters in this team, that you can speak truly your mind and make a difference? And if you do feel that your opinion doesn't matter, do you trust your colleagues? Do you trust that guy that works alongside you have been working with you for the past 5 years? If you think, I like the children, you know, even though I don't have children, I like the children description that a colleague of mine told me, which is, I will never let my children with this guy. So if you think some people take projects as children, you know, and take care of them until they are, you know, old enough to leave home, and sometimes they are never old enough to leave home, but if you think on that colleague that works with you, would you trust him or her to take care of your projects, of the stuff and tasks that you are working on? If not, the question is, what would have to change for you to trust in that person? How can you give this feedback to them? And the last question, and not an easy one, is, do you know the value that the work you do brings to your team and your company? Have you ever heard about the brag document? Do you know on what are you contributing to? I'll have to share the link with you. I just pulled the brag document. Brag document is a document that you do as a diary regarding your steps into projects. So for example, I'm working every day, I work into different projects. At the end of the week or at the end of the day, I go there and write down what I've been doing into some of those projects. Bullet points, easy. What this brag document gives to me, the power to go to my boss into every performance review and say, hey, I did all of this. I faced all of these adversities. And in all of them, I thrived, or in some of them, I thrived. In others, I keep repeating myself. And that's why I think I deserve a raise or a promotion, or I deserve your place or something like that. And if you do this, you can start to see the difference you make into the company and the difference that you make into the team. What are the areas of responsibility that you have, where you are the center of knowledge, and how you should share or can share that knowledge with your team. And that's it from my part. Do you have any questions? No discussions? Either I was super clear or you didn't understand nothing, but it happens. So thank you so much for coming. I do hope that you have a safe journey into the sea of agile and work that you have in front of you. If you need anything or want to discuss this further into a more private forum, I am more than available on that. You have my LinkedIn and maybe my email. So thank you so much for coming. That's it.